Can you hear me?
Hello, sir. Good morning.
Okay, try to answer this question. Simple, basic question. Getting the question right? Two complex numbers z1, z2. They are equal. So does that mean r1 equal to r2 and theta1 equal to
r2? Yes.
Okay, how do you show that? Or how do you understand this one?
Sir, if two complex numbers are L, then r1 and their argument will be have to be equal, right? Then only they will be equal.
Yeah. Complex number can be represented as a point in the xy plane.
Yeah.
So two complex numbers are same, then they are the same point.
Yeah.
So given a point, there is unique r and unique theta. So once the point is fixed, r and theta are fixed. Okay. And it also means that real part of z1 should be equal to real part of z2.
Yeah.
And also the imaginary parts. Is clear, no?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Last time I did this question. The given thing is they are given two complex numbers which satisfy this one and also this one. Okay. And then you have to find the argument of Z. Okay. So I have taken two complex numbers as this one. Z1 equal to R1, theta1. And W as R2 theta2. Okay, from that Z bar will be I minus theta1 and W bar will be minus theta2 and IW bar, right? So this is one, and after that, given that theta1 plus theta2 is pi, right? This relation,
yeah,
okay, and from this one. I get Z bar as this one. Okay. And here, if I take mod on both the sides, this will mean that R1 equal to R2. Because these are two complex numbers. The Z bar is conjugate, right? So the conjugate will also have the same R1. Only the angle will be minus. Okay. Here, the mod of minus I is 1. And this mod of W bar will be R2. This thing. So R1 equal to R2. From that, I'll get this value theta1, theta2 constrained as this one. Theta1 minus theta2.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's not difficult. And we have this relation theta1 plus theta2. So using these two, I can get theta1 as minus pi by 4 and theta2 as pi by 4. Because when I add them, I should get pi. Okay. But the given answer is 3π/4 for theta1. Okay. So if this value of theta1 is -π/4, the complex numbers are like this. -π/4 and 5π/4. Okay. So these are the two complex numbers. This is z, -π/4. All these angles are 45 degrees. Okay. So this is Z and this is W. 5π/4 is pi plus pi by 4. Okay. So this is Z, means Z bar will be here. This is the angle will get negative sign, right?
Mm.
Okay. And W bar will be here.
Mm.
Okay. And I into W bar means if I multiply this number, it will get rotated by the angle. And the magnitude of I is 1. So the magnitude will not change. So it will get rotated by 90 degrees. Okay, so it will sit on this one. So here, now Z bar plus I W are in opposite directions. So if I add them, I'll get 0. Z bar and I W bar. So that is this condition. Z bar plus I W bar equal to 0. Okay. So I omega W bar is here, that you heard, no?
Yes, sir.
From that, Z bar plus I W bar will be zero because they are in opposite directions. So that is the condition he has given here.
Yes.
And then argument of Z and W, if I add them, I should get pi. That is true. Because minus pi before, pi plus pi before. So these two complex numbers satisfy the given conditions. Okay.
Yeah.
So that minus pi before option is not here. But even the if we take this as pi, 3 pi by 4, and I'll get the other minus pi by 4. So the complex numbers are this one now.
Okay.
Now the Z is this one, 3 pi by 4. And this pi by 4, and W bar is this one, and Z bar is this one, and I W bar will be this one. So here also, Z bar plus I W bar is 0. Okay, so there are two answers for this question, but what I got from the first one is not matching with it. So one thing you should try to do is, whenever you get an argument of a complex number, try to restrict the argument of any complex number between minus pi and pi.
Oh.
Okay. There, then the chance of getting the right answer, whatever the given answer is, more. Because you can cover this full plane from minus pi and then to plus pi. Okay. Don't include minus pi, include plus pi. Okay.
Okay.
You don't have to include both. So,
stop sharing.
Oh.
Yeah, now it's okay.
So there is identity like this, cos theta plus cos 2 theta plus cos 3 theta plus 1 up to cos n theta equal to the right hand side. To prove this thing, you have to take z1 as e raised to I theta, which is cos theta plus I sin theta. Okay, and Z2 as series by I2 theta, and so on like that. Okay, so now if you take Z1 plus Z2 plus 1 plus Zn, it will be series by I theta plus series by I2 theta plus 1 plus series by I n theta. And that will be equal to, I can combine all the real parts, cos theta, cos 2 theta like that. And then the imaginary parts, right? And this one is a GP. This one, okay, and sum of a GP is given like this. Right now, we take it as a formula. It is this is a formula. A is the first term, and R is the common ratio. Okay, so the first term here is e raised to I theta, and the common ratio also the same thing. Okay, so the first identity is the real part of this one. So if you do some simplification, and finally get this inequality. Maybe for solving problems, you may have to remember this result. Okay. Similarly, for if you equate the imaginary part, you get the sum of sine plus sines. Okay. Try this question. This is a very simple one.
So, it's x-axis.
Yeah. So, mod of numerator denominator can be written separately. So mod of this thing should be similar to this one. And mod of Z minus Z naught is distance from point Z naught. So phi A is here and minus phi A is here. So Z should be equal distance from these two points. So any point here, so, equal distance from these two.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the x-axis. Okay, this one.
Sir, I didn't get it.
Okay, he has given mod of Z1 equal to 1, right?
Yeah. So
that also means that mod of 1 by Z1 is 1. Okay, because mod of numerator divided by mod of denominator. So the mod of denominator should be equal to 1. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and he is asked to find mod of Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3, right? Okay, let me call it that as k, and I have to find k. Okay, so mod of something equal to some number means the complex number into its conjugate is k square. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and this conjugate will get distributed, so it will become like this. Right?
Okay.
And now I can multiply. Now I think you can proceed.
Yes, sir. Now I can proceed. Got it.
What is the answer?
A equal to 1.
Okay. So from this you can get this one. And also you have one more relation. This mod of this thing is equal to 1. This one, right? So from this you have to write this one. And only when you subtract these two, you will get this one. And one more thing you have to use is this one. Z by 1 by Z is mod of Z square minus 1 minus 1 divided by the denominator, because Z into Z bar is mod Z square. Okay. And if I use this for Z1, Z2, Z3, it will be equal to 0, because mod of Z1 is 1. Okay. And when I subtract these two are reciprocals. This one and this one are reciprocals, right? Or reciprocal with a conjugate. Here I am having Zn 1 by Z bar. So here my complex number Z is this one, and reciprocal of it with a conjugate. If I add these two or subtract these two, it will become 0. So all these terms will get cancelled with these terms. And 3 and 3 will cancel. So k square minus 1 should be equal to 0. From that I'll get k equal to 1. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is one more thing you have to realize. This one. Z plus Z minus reciprocal of Z conjugate. If I add them, it will become 0, because mod Z is equal to 1. Okay, the B part, it's independent of the A part. The argument of Z is negative. And so one more basic thing here is, whenever mod of something is given, use this relation, because this will be easy to manipulate. The complex number its conjugate is the square of the modulus. Okay. Okay.
Yes, sir.
B part argument Z is negative. So from the derivative argument minus Z minus argument minus Z, Z equal to something.
Got it, sir.
Yeah, I'm taking Z as R into angle theta, and minus Z is minus R, this one. And minus 1 I can write as E is for I pi. Okay, so it will become like this. So now the argument, if I subtract this to, I'll get as pi. Try to, whenever you're putting the argument, try to put restrict in this range so that you will not miss the correct answer. Okay, this is the catch. Got it? Because here I'm putting minus 1 as E is for I pi.
Yes.
And one more thing he has given us. Theta is less than negative. Theta is negative, right? So when theta is negative, this thing is less than pi. Because according to this range, the argument should not go greater than pi. Okay. But minus 1, I have written as e raised to the I pi. I can also write as e raised to the power minus I pi. Pi and minus pi are same point, right? Okay. But if you take minus pi, theta is negative, so it will go beyond this range. We take minus 1 as plus pi, and theta is negative that he has given. Theta is negative. Okay. So if I take plus pi, if theta is negative, then this argument will be in this range. Okay. So make sure you are not going out of this range in the argument of any complex number. right? Got it?
Yes.
Okay, this one. These are two complex numbers. Okay.
Yeah.
So this is final point minus initial point. So Z1 is final point and Z3 is initial point. And for the denominator, Z2 is the final point and Z3 is initial point. So divide directly is like this. And so the denominator complex number multiplied by this one. This is the complex number at this point. Because the real part is positive, imagine y part is negative. So this is the fourth quadrant and the angle is pi by 3, actually minus pi by 3. So the so basically the angle is 60 degrees. Okay, and in the clockwise direction. Okay, so if you take this second this thing and rotate it by 60 degrees in the clockwise direction, I'll get the numerator complex number. And the magnitude of this one is 1. Okay, the magnitude of these two complex numbers are the same and they are separated by 60 degrees. So it's an equilateral triangle. Okay, all this justification is there. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this one.
Sir, 4K.
Yeah. See, n cubed means it is 1 raised to the power 1 by n, right? Okay, and 1 is e raised to the power I 2k pi by n. So this one is 1 raised to the power 1 by n, right? And 1 is e raised to the power I 2k pi. Okay, and let z1 correspond to k1. Okay, and similarly z2 will correspond to k2. So theta 1 minus theta 2 is 2 pi by n, k1 minus k2, and that should be equal to pi by 2. These two Z1 Z2 need not be consecutive in through. They can be separated by some angle, okay? And that separation is pi by 2. So from that we get 4 times K1 minus K2 as N. And K1 and K2 are integers or natural numbers. So K1 minus K2 is also an integer. Okay, this is one way of doing it. The other way is the any two consecutive N through will be separated by an angle of 2 pi by n. Is that right? Two successive?
Yes.
And these two are some n truths. So, integer multiple of this one should be pi by 2. Because z1 is equal to some n root of 1. So, this could be this one and z2 can be here. Okay. And the separation will be the integer multiple of 2 pi by n, right? That should be pi by 2. So from this we get n as 4 times integer. Got it?
Yes.
This one. Omega is done. You
sir,
know
how do you?
Yeah, determinant property you don't know, right? Okay, let me just.
No,
tell the result you just accepted now. So first thing is omega is given as this one. So this is cube root of unity, right? That you should recognize.
Yeah.
Okay, this minus half and root 3 by 2, it's basically 60 degrees. And this is in the second quadrant. And omega square will be in the fourth quadrant. Okay, so first you have to recognize omega is a w, omega is a cube root of unity. And the determinant property is there. If you take a determinant and see this first column, this is called column.
Yeah.
This is the first column. This is the third column. So I'm keeping the first column and third column as same. And to the second column, I'm adding first column and third column. Or in other words, I'm adding all the three columns and putting it here. This is called column operation, and this will leave the determinant value unchanged. Just accept it now. You will learn it when you learn determinants later. So that operation I'm performing. So when I add all these three columns, I'll get 3, and here I'll get 0. The 0 is clear. 0, and then this one I'll get omega plus omega square plus omega, this is about 4. Okay. And this determinant I can open up by expanding along this column. So that will be 3 into these two. Okay. So that's what I've written here. And then 0 into that one, that will not come. And similarly, this one into these two. Okay. How to expand determinant, maybe you learn it later. Okay, only once you expand, you get this thing, and then you have to realize that omega raised to the power 4 is equal to omega. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Because omega raised to the power 4 is omega cube into omega. And omega is cube root, right? So omega cube is 1. So omega raised to the power 4 is omega. Okay? And 1 plus omega plus omega square is 0. That is shown in the property of cube root, right? In the first previous slide. Here, 1 plus omega square equal to 0. It's like three vectors equally spaced. So sum of the three vectors should be 0. What we can put here, e raised to the power I 2 pi by 3 and e raised to the power I 4 pi by 3. And then expand it, you will get this result. Okay, so this is equal to 0. Okay, so only this term will remain. So if we take 3 and w out, it will become 3w into omega minus 1. So it matches with this one. Okay.
Yes, sir.
This one.
Sir, how to do this?
Yeah, so right, alpha is a complex number satisfying this one. Okay, this equation is given here, no? This one is a geometric progression.
Oh.
Okay, so the sum of that thing is this one.
Sir, I don't know geometric progression, I only know AP, not GP.
Okay, GP the from one to another term, you have to multiply with a constant number. So first term you multiply by alpha, you get the second term. Second term multiply alpha with the third term, so on. Okay, and the sum of GP, I have given a formula, right? This formula. E into R is equal to minus 1, okay, R minus 1. This is the GP. Okay. So just use this formula. So if you use the formula, A is 1. So I have not written it. So 1 minus R raised to the power n divided by 1 minus R. Okay. So this is equal to, so this is a question because we have to show this one. So let's say I put a question. Or this thing should be true. This and this are same except for instead of P, I'm using Q. Okay, so I have to show either this is true or this is true. Okay, and alpha not equal to 1, that means the denominator is not 0. Right, so this is where I am using that alpha is not equal to 1 condition. Okay, so I have to show either this or this is true. And the given equation, this one, can be written like this. Right? This one.
Yeah.
You can factorize like this one. Okay. And alpha is the root of this equation. So this condition is, we'll get this condition. So this equal to 0 means either one of them is. Either one of them is 0 or both is also 0. That's also possible. So 1 raised to the power 1 by p. So alpha is p root of 1 or q root of 1. Okay. And if alpha is p root of 1, then this first factor is 0. Okay. Now, and if alpha is q root of 1, then the second factor is 0. Okay, so now we have to both cannot be zero same time. That is true because they are prime numbers. See, the nth root of the pth root of unity will be separated by this angle of 2 pi by p, right? It will be on a circle. So all the pth roots will be separated by an angle of 2 pi by p. Similarly, the qth root will be separated by 2 pi by q. Okay, so alpha can be either one of these pth root or one of these qth root, or not both. That is possible if this angle is not matching with this angle. See, suppose I divide this 360 degrees by 30 degrees and 360 degrees by 60 degrees, then two divisions of this one will match with one division of this one, right? Got it. But since they are prime numbers, this sort of a thing is not possible. Because they say 360 by 3 and 360 by 7. The integer multiple of this one will not match with this one. Right? If you take 6 and 3, 2 times 3 is 6. Okay, but if you take two prime numbers, say 2 and 5, I cannot express one as some factor into the other one. Okay, so if you take alpha as one of the p root, it will not coincide with the q root, because they are prime numbers. Got it? So suppose if p is 3, okay, and q is 6, okay, so 6 divisions of q will match with 3 divisions of p. Okay, if I take this will be q roots will be located here, 1, 2, 3, and the pth root, the first pth root will be here. Okay, and the third pth root will coincide. If they are not prime numbers, if they are prime, that sort of thing is not possible. So both cannot be, so one cannot be both pth root and qth root. It can be either pth root or qth root. Not both. Okay. This product of these two equal to zero means either this is equal to zero or this is equal to zero, or both can be zero. But in this particular case, both cannot be zero because p and q are prime numbers. Okay. Right. This one. Did a simple one, just that you have to try to use conjugates.
Yeah. Okay, sir, I understood. Zero.
Yeah. So once conjugate of a complex number is given as one, okay, it immediately means that z into z bar is 1. And to get real part of a complex number, you can take its conjugate and divide it by 2. Okay? So if you use these things, it's easy to manipulate. And since omega or w is this one, omega bar will be this one. If you use these things, you will get as 0. Okay? So always try to use conjugates so that manipulation will be easier. Right. Try this one. You are progressing.
Yes, sir, but I'm getting like.
Okay, this thing means this one, right? That complex number into its conjugate is less than or equal to 1 square. Okay, So this we have to show. That's why I put a question mark. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Now you can see the denominator is z minus z1 minus z2 and z1 minus z2 bar. It's a product of these two is a positive quantity. Complex number in this conjugate is r square, right?
Mm.
Okay. So since it's a positive quantity, I can take on the other side of the inequality, and the inequality side will not reverse. This I have to make sure. I'm undertaking the process of inequality by some quantity. That should, quantity should be positive. If it is not positive, then the inequality sign will reverse. But this into this is positive. That's why I've taken it here. Okay. Mm. And the inequality sign will not change. Now we have to just simplify. Cancel things. And then you can factorize. You'll get this one. So this is equal to zero. So one of them should be positive and one of them should be negative. So here one of them is less than one, other one is greater than one.
Okay.
So this is true. But for the given condition, this is less than zero. So this is question mark has become true now. Okay.
Yeah.
Here are your factors.
Okay.
Try this one. Okay, this is not very, just have to realize one thing. If you have complex numbers z1, z2, z1, zn, and if you add them and take the mod, that will be less than or equal to sum of individual mods.
Okay.
This is like triangle inequality. We have we can form a triangle with complex numbers z1, z2, and z1 plus z2, and c is less than or equal to a plus b. So that we can extend it to inside polygon. This also can understood in terms of vectors. If you have n vectors like this, okay, and this will be the final sum, right? So the length of this thing is less than or equal to the sum of individual vectors, right?
Yes, sir.
So that's where you can remember this inequality. So here, this is sum of z1 plus z2 plus, right? And the full sum is equal to 1. So if you take the individual mods, I can take mod on both the sides. So if you take the individual mods, that will be greater than or equal to 1. Right? This is sum of some complex numbers. Okay.
So yes, sir.
Mod of individual quantities, that will be greater than or equal to the total mod, and total mod is equal to 1. That's why it's greater than or equal to 1. Okay. And if this is greater than 1, then A1, mod of A1, mod of A2 is always less than or equal to 2. Less than 2. Okay. Mod of E1 is less than 2. So this thing is greater than 1. Yes. Okay. So from this, this is a GP. Right. And you're using the result of the sum of GP. Okay. So from this, you can simplify and get mod Z is greater than 1 by 3 plus some results. This is a positive quantity. So it's greater than Z by 3. Okay. So the complex number should be greater than Z by 3. But he's saying, if the complex number is less than 1 by 3, then there is no solution. Okay, I'm getting some doubt in this step. How is this step 2? This is fine. This step is okay. I'm putting a E1. I'm putting a quantity which is less than. All right. Okay. So this is two. This step is 2. And if you replace A1 by a quantity bigger than A1, which is 2, then this thing will also be true. This thing is true by the triangle inequality. Okay. Now I'm replacing A1 by a quantity bigger than A1, which is 2. So when I replace a quantity, this thing should be true. And so this thing has to be true. And for this thing to be true, this has to be the condition, which is contradicting with the given condition. So with a given condition, this is not possible. Okay. There are two important things to realize here. One is this inequality. After that, you have to use this condition. Okay. So once you do that, you'll get this sum as a GP. Right. So the complex number XI sheet is, you have seen it or not?
I've seen it, sir.